start with the very first question, which is to ask you to briefly describe the museum activism project.
Well, in 2017, we began to discuss the idea for a book that would explore what we sense to be an emerging or changing global turn in museum thinking and practice. The increasing prevalence of work that was seeking to harness the unique resources, capacities, and potential of museums as forces for good in society. And the result was our book, Museum Activism, which was published in 2019 by Routledge in London and New York. It's an anthology of research that brings together 51 contributors from six continents, including museum practitioners, academics, artists, researchers, and activists, who seek not only to draw attention to the emergence of museum activism, but also to amplify, nurture, and enrich it. And when we chose the word activism, we went beyond the common understanding of the word. We don't see it as protests or demonstrations or civil disobedience. Rather, museum activism is practice that is shaped out of ethically informed values, and it's intended to address the inequalities, injustice, and environmental challenges that all museums and their communities are now facing. This book has been called the handbook for this sort of urgent task, and we're so pleased to be able to share the work of all these dedicated and gifted contributors.
And what would you say is the history of this awarded initiative? Can you summarize the rationale, the objectives, and the aims?
Bob and I both have a long-standing interest in the potential for museums to function as a force for good in the world. In our professional practice over many, many years, and in our research and scholarship, we've both pursued this idea. And we both began to see a new idea emerging around the world of the museum as a force for good, taking shape in lots and lots of different contexts. And in 2017, we began working together on a book that would explore this global trend. This move away from the museum as somehow detached or neutral or authoritative towards an institution more deeply immersed in the world it inhabits that seeks to address inequities and injustices and crises. And perhaps most importantly, in terms of our aims, we didn't want to simply document this new form of museum, but we wanted to amplify it, to stimulate, to support more experimental thinking and practice that would enable more and more museums to work in this way and unleash their potential to bring about positive change in the world.
That's very good. And in this sense, what do you think were the particular qualities or innovations that impressed the prize jury?
Well, I think one of the most important considerations was that there was simply no other book quite like this. There have been articles and commentaries, yes, but no comprehensive examination of this brave new world for museums. But in addition to its originality, the book was cited for its intellectual and social outreach. As we mentioned, over 51 authors from six continents contributed chapters, providing an unrivaled global perspective on this kind of work. And to directly support accessibility, this book is also available on Google Scholar, where it can be accessed free of charge, and the page size is adaptable for sight-impaired readers. Also, the book was praised for immersing the reader in new and innovative ideas, experiments, and test cases, as well as offering practical ideas for how to go about this work. And throughout the book, the reader is constantly challenged with the question, what can I do, what will I do to actively and positively contribute to changing the world to make it a better place? In addition, museum activism was recognized for clearly articulating a call to action to reach beyond current museum practices and assumptions in search of real community relevance and meaning and engagement, and also calling on museums to become more collaborative, more participatory, and to focus their work on value-based work. And last, museum activism was commended for its appeal to our collective imagination, asking museum workers to develop the ideas not only about what museums are, but what they could be around the world. Our book puts forward a clear vision for the future of museums, while I said earlier, offering case studies, new practices, and lessons learned to serve as a guide for getting there.
Okay, and what would you say that the word, the difficulties, but also the positive experiences that you had during the book realization?
probably the biggest difficulty we had would be selecting the range of contributors and projects for the book. We put out an open call through our networks, our global networks. We had our eye on some particular really innovative projects and people working in this area, but actually we received a real wealth of contributions, many, many more than we had expected came back, which was exciting, but it did present a big challenge because we wanted to get some breadth and geographical coverage and depth, but we simply couldn't include everybody. So it was a tough set of choices to make. But perhaps the most positive thing then was the relationship that we developed with each of those 51 contributors, because we entered into a sustained process of dialogue, review and feedback, and we were really blown away by the dedication and the effort that all of those contributors put in to really hone and polish their contributions and create really accessible and engaging writing.
I think you have spoken a little bit about that already, but I would like to ask anyways, what are the social impacts of this project after its publication?
Well, museum books never receive formal evaluations like most museum exhibitions do. But we do have abundant evidence that the book has been well and seriously received. Beginning with the book sales alone, our publisher is delighted to see how good the sales have been and how we've been reaching so many people working in the field. The book's also been reviewed in at least a dozen publications, and all the reviews have been resoundingly positive. Now, admittedly, those examples are anecdotal, but we do have a very concrete example of the impact of this work on the museum community. Because following on from the book, Richard and I decided to collaborate in 2020 to support the research and development of activist museum projects that reflect the ideas that were presented in the book. Ideas, experiments, and practices that are intended to inspire and support museum activism throughout the UK museum community, but also globally. So we got together and we raised the funding and we established the first Museum Activist Award at the Research Center for Museums and Galleries in the School of Museum Studies at the University of Leicester in the UK. And we've now completed our second round of Activist Museum Awards and are delighted to have supported six separate projects. We're looking forward to a third year of making awards now coming this fall. And each winner is given £1,000 as well as a tailored mentorship program to support the development of their ideas. We have no doubt that all these projects are having immediate social impacts, not only in the museum community, but in the communities at large. And these range from the Climate Museum UK to the International Slavery Museum to the Museum of Transology. So the Activist Museum Award is a concrete legacy of our book, which we hope will continue to support and nurture activist museum practices far into the future.
In what ways does this book relate to different audiences, and what do you think that attracts them? You have already spoken about selling the book and also about accessibility, but maybe you could develop more about how diverse is the audience of this book?
Typically, book projects of this kind appeal to a particular group of museum workers, you know, maybe educators and public programming staff or curators or managers. But museum activism has a much broader appeal because the ideas, the underpinning concepts, the underpinning philosophy reach across the whole breadth of the museum, all of its functions and activities. And I think that means that there's something in there for museum workers of all kinds. I think also its appeal is enhanced because the topics it looks at are incredibly timely, very, very pressing for so many museums around the world. If you look at the themes within it that are explored, from anti-racism and decolonization to the climate crisis to anti-ableism, they're all issues that are addressed within the book and which are playing out for museums of all kinds across the world in different ways. I think lastly, some of the appeal lies in the diversity of contributors. You know, we have established scholars, we have emerging thinkers, we have artists, we have activists. So a range of different voices in there, from so many different parts of the world that I think readers who might very often read something and think that's from an entirely different context are seeing that the ideas, the worldviews, the perspectives that are put forward chime in some way with their own practice, their own worlds that they're inhabiting.
Thank you. My last question, I think I would like you to freely comment on that. After looking to the intensification of social movements and community action reaching museums in the past years, and I would say specifically considering the changes in museums during the pandemic time in the past 1 year and a half, how do you consider that the chapters in this book may contribute to some possible ways for a museum transformation into the future? What aspects would you say that we can see that museums are transforming and this book could contribute for this transformation?
We thought a lot about how we could contribute to transforming museums when we designed the book and its contents and in selecting the contributors that we did. This was really one of our central aims. How can we support transformation? Because as Richard said earlier, both of us have devoted most of our careers to this notion of social responsibility, activism, and change, and the value of museums within their societies. So we were committed to offering both practical methods as well as theoretical insights into this notion of transformation. So we designed the book with three parts. And the first part is nurturing activism. And that examines traditional museum practices and what could or should change for museums as they seek to become more activists. So very practical, nurturing activism. The second part is activism in practice. And there we explored actions that have been taken by museums around the world, as well as lessons learned from specific case studies. And then the third part is we took a broader view and we assessed this notion of activism and we delved into the challenges and issues to consider when museums make the commitment to contribute to cultural change, environmental change, and adopt a sort of activist perspective. So those three parts, we think, sort of lay the groundwork for this notion of transformation for whomever is interested in embarking on that work. Richard, you may want to add to that.
You know, there are so many different kinds of museum, different kinds of social and environmental and political issue that we explore in the book, but a really common thread is the capacity for individuals, wherever they're working, at whatever level of the organization, to be able to move forward somehow with this idea of harnessing the museum as a force for good. You know, not everybody has the freedom to direct or channel a whole amount of resources, but the idea of personal agency, being able to bring your own values into the workplace and look at ways, large and small, to make a change, to contribute to social good, is definitely a thread throughout the book. And I think contributes in some way to its appeal because it gives people an opportunity to see the part that they can play in transforming museums. I think, you know, we published this in 2019 and so much has happened since, and it requires you then to reflect on what is the ongoing value of a work that was produced before the whole world changed. In some ways, I think we both feel that its relevance has been enhanced by the pandemic, certainly here and in other parts of the world by the resurgence of social movements like the Black Lives Matter movement, because it calls on museums to be responsive to those things, to not be detached, but to be actively engaged in that work and the challenges and demands that those changes present, however difficult that might be.
And if I could just add to that, both Richard and I believe that museums everywhere actually are in need of transformation. And if you just look at a sort of simplistic evolutionary trajectory of museums, you know, they began as elite collections, often from imperial dominance. They then evolved into institutions for public education. And now many museums are sort of malls. They've become an appendage of consumer society with an emphasis on entertainment and consumption. And we think that a fourth stage or transformation, as you called it, it is now apparent and it's necessary. And we hope that this next iteration of museums will allow museums to become institutions of the commons, that is, belonging to the whole community, as key civic resources which are responsive to citizens' interests and concerns and grounded in enhancing societal well-being. And we really want to emphasize that this isn't an either-or proposition. I mean, museums can continue to maintain their core work of collections and educations while engaging in this new perspective. And we're hoping that our book will not only serve as a handbook, which as it's been called, but it's also been called a wake-up call and an insider's guide to making this happen. And we really couldn't have hoped for anything more as authors and as museologists, because as far as we can see, museum activism is well underway.
Do you want to add anything that's not completed in these questions or the comments?
Well, I would just say that we're very honored to be considered laureates in the Best of Heritage project. And we congratulate you and your colleagues, Bruno, for all that good work and for bringing museum work to the forefront of public attention.
Great. Do you have any final words, Richard?
One of the things I'd like to end on is, you know, it's a great honor and an opportunity for Bob and I to meet you and share our thoughts with this. It is very much a collaborative endeavor. As you've heard, the work of many, many people contributed to the final output, museum activism. And for us, it created a fantastic network of people we got to know better through that process, and to be able to shine a light on their incredibly innovative, experimental, very bold ways of working that we can look at more closely and draw on as inspiration as we seek to change museums in all sorts of ways. So we'd like to give our thanks and gratitude to them for what has become a much more collaborative endeavour than perhaps a book is more usually, a slightly more solo or individual project.
Okay, that's a nice comment. So thank you very much.